On land, all of the Earth's monsters have been collected and are living together in a place called Monsterland.
Look! You fools! You're in danger! They're here already! You're next!
The views and opinions expressed do not necessarily reflect those of Access Fort Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting groups.
Take your stinking paws off me, you damn dirty ape!
If you'd like to produce a show, call us at 260-421-1250.
You're next! You're next! You're next!
I see we have guests. Good evening, my children of the grave. I bid you welcome to the Haunted Hotel. I am the night manager and your host of horror, Mr. Graves. Thank you for staying with us. Let me call the Bell Beast and have it ready your tomb. Bang! Number 13. Now, while Fang busies itself making your tomb livable, come and join me for tonight's Dead Time Story as we present to you Chosen Survivors, starring Jackie Cooper and Bradford Dillman. A group of diverse individuals are taken from their homes and flown to an undisclosed location out in the desert, where they enter a bomb shelter a third of a mile beneath the surface of the Earth. When they arrive, they are informed that a nuclear holocaust is taking place, and they've been chosen by computer to survive to continue the human race. The bomb shelter is equipped for them to live comfortably for 3 years. However, a problem arises that no one could have anticipated. A group of bloodthirsty vampire bats has also found their way into the bomb shelter and pick off the humans one at a time. Will any of them be able to survive, to continue mankind? Let's find out. Now why don't you pull up a tombstone, crawl under your grave blanket, and hold on tight to your ghoul friend while I turn down the lights and then begin tonight's Dead Time Story. Chosen Survivors.
United States of America, I would like to welcome you to the beginning of the greatest adventure of your lives. You are all sedated to ease the shock of what has happened. Faced with the threat of worldwide development of atomic weapons, a special government committee set into action a plan to provide for the continuation of the human race in the event of global thermonuclear war. You are here because we are now engaged in such a war. Foresight on the part of this nation's leaders has allowed us to make limited survival possible. In 12 locations within the borders of this country, installations such as this are now operational. Those of you in this room, along with the 168 men and women in the other installations, were computer selected for the special knowledge each of you can transmit to the future. Other considerations were sex, age, and physical superiority. Within the 26 rooms and more than 18,000 square feet in this self-maintained installation, you will find all necessary life support supplies allowing for up to 5 years confinement and all necessary instructional material. You can view any part of North America in detail via synchronous observation satellites with which you are linked. Ultimately, when your computers indicate that the radiation level on the surface has fallen below the safety threshold, the elevator in your complex will become automatically operable and you will be able to return to the surface. It is our hope that you and the 168 chosen survivors like you will find the strength to transcend this greatest of all tragedies so that humanity will not have perished because of the actions of a few, but will flourish again because of the courage of a few. May God bless you. This message was pre-recorded and automatically programmed.
Thank you. thought it would really happen.
Who are you?
Major Gordon Ellis, U.S. Army.
What are you doing here?
I am responsible for the maintenance of the computer and the life support systems in this complex.
How do you happen to be here now?
If it wasn't me, it would have been the officer that alternated with me.
Where exactly are we?
You are 1,758 feet underground. New Mexico, they tell me.
What do you mean they tell you?
They didn't want me to know. They flew me in and flew me out every time. Desert's pretty much the same every place.
What if something goes wrong down here? Some kind of a failure?
We'll just have to repair it.
You have the equipment, tools?
Yes, we have everything here.
Living accommodations?
There are private rooms for everyone. Each with its own bath and a closet full of clothes.
Total. Thermonuclear destruction. 4 billion people.
Effective altitude of 1,200 miles. The cameras are programmed to move in automatically. This is the southern hemisphere. We'll be getting views of the South Pole on this screen. The atmosphere's on fire. It looks as though a chain reaction is taking place. America now. Southern California and Arizona. Now this is from an altitude of 50,000 feet. We're centered in on San Francisco. Or rather, what's left of it.
Oh my God.
What's the temperature of the ocean on the coast?
The surface temperature is 214 degrees Fahrenheit.
I don't want to see anymore. I can't see anymore.
You have to see it all.
What do you want to see? A million charred bodies? I doubt
that any of our group accepts what was seen and heard today. And I'm sure it's for the best. The brain has a way of rejecting information that's too painful for it to tolerate all at once. For me, as a behavioral scientist, the individual reactions are fascinating. Dr. Lenore Chrisman, Nobel Prize-winning medical researcher, and Luis Cabral, an oceanographer from Scripps, have recovered enough to begin exploring this remarkable environment. Right, Stephen Mays, the novelist, and Congresswoman Alana Fitzgerald are trying to deal positively with the situation by discussing it with each other. However, they're not even convinced they want to be alive with everyone else dead. Others of the group are trying to avoid facing the situation. Former Olympic gold medal winner Woody Russo, whose past has been a constant struggle for identity, drives beyond endurance to block out all thoughts of the future. While for Carrie Draper, the talented ecology expert, escape takes the form of retreat into the diversions of the past, recreations of happier moments. The memories of biologist Claire Faraday bring her solace and strength. A life lived fully, with family, home, and the precious experience of having loved and been loved. Christine Lerner, the young nutritionist, is perhaps the most vulnerable of the group. She appears to be dangerously close to total withdrawal. The very emptiness of her life makes the future unthinkable. Ray Cousins, the corporation genius, refuses to accept the situation in any terms. He's too busy looking for a way out. Eventually, hopefully, the thoughts of all will turn to the present, and we will constructively begin to cope with the unique problems we face in the future.
You can't sleep either, huh, Major?
I was just having some coffee. There's some more in the kitchen if you like.
No.
Major, you strike me as an intelligent man. You're an engineer, a man who deals in facts. I, too, am a man who deals in facts. I want to know what this is all about.
What's all about?
Major, I'd like you to listen very carefully to what I have to say. Now, I'm very concerned for all of us. And I want to help all of us. You see, it's my feeling there's a way out of here. And I think you know what that is. Get us out of here, Major, and I'll make you a rich man.
There is no way, Mr. Cousins.
I suggest you think about that, Major.
There is no price because there is no way. Believe me, Mr. Cousins.
Good night, Major.
Good night.
Thank you.
morning, chosen survivors. Good morning to the first day of the new world. I would like to begin by suggesting that you include on your agenda for today's activities a complete tour of your facility. The environmental system in which you are living is the most sophisticated and secure that modern technology could design. Learn what it has to offer in helping you to adjust. You will find that all the life support systems are fully automated, and they have built-in backup systems in the event anything malfunctions. The primary power supply is normally maintained by solar energy. But for the present, until the dust settles and the radiation level decreases, we are operating on a nuclear generator that normally supplies backup power. Everything within the complex is recycled. Air, water, waste.
I wonder why they used her.
There is
probably because they wanted someone who smiled a lot.
12 hours ago, you people were on the verge of hysteria. Now listen to me.
There's no changing what's already happened, Mr. Cousins. Anything wrong with trying to make the best of it?
The lab contains the most advanced equipment and supplies necessary for research and emergency purposes. The gymnasium is equipped with everything from jump ropes to vibrator belts. It is essential that each of you remains at the peak of physical fitness through the years. And now, until next time, this is Mary Louise Borden, wishing you happiness and continued good fortune in the exciting days, months, and years to come. This message was pre-recorded and automatically programmed.
Look! Vessels are severed. But there's no blood coagulation.
That's impossible.
Come on, Christina. We've got to find the others. Hurry, Christina. Hurry. What is it?
I don't know. The blue light's emergency power. I'm going to check the circuit room.
Help!
Carrie Draper, she said she was going to have another little round.
It's what killed the birds.
Desmodus rotundus, commonly known as the vampire bat.
What the hell was it doing down here?
Eating, Mr. Cousins. Birds. This explains why there was no blood coagulation where the bird was bitten. A vampire bat's saliva contains an anticoagulant that causes the victim's blood to continue to flow after it's been bitten.
How did a bat get down here?
The government didn't just
dig a hole and plant this installation. They found caves, converted them. Bats live in caves.
Do you believe only one bat killed all those birds?
I don't know. Desmodus rotundus lives on fresh blood, nothing else. It consumes its own weight in blood every day.
What if there are others?
Well, let's be realistic. There's no blood source on the surface. So they're either going to cannibalize each other or...
or find their way back in here.
What does your instruction manual say about that, Major? How do you handle blood-sucking bats?
And how do you handle rabies?
Inoculations are effective for at least a year.
Now, I'd certainly like to know the Joker responsible for this oversight.
Mr. Cousins, this complex was built to be impregnable. There's no possible way that anything or anybody could get in it.
Or out. If what you tell me is true, Major. But we do know a bat did get in here.
It's just possible that it was in the elevator with us.
One of us would have seen it.
In the state we were in, it is possible we could have missed seeing it.
A week before you were brought here, supplies were coming in day and night. The elevator was the only access. It was used at least 50 times a day.
Are you telling us the government anticipated this happening at least a week before it did?
The government might have. In Washington, one finds that major secrets are kept from people every day. It's always been that way.
What I'm getting at is that it's possible the bat got in the elevator and got down here before any of you did.
If that were true, what was it feeding on before it got to the birds?
Well, we're just going to have to search every room in this place, every inch of it, every conduit, every vent, and find out how the thing got in here, and then make sure that there are no others.
Speakers, air conditioning grids, all clean.
Let's not forget one thing. Bats are nocturnal. They can't tolerate light.
What she is saying, Major Ellis, is that we better make damn sure what happened to our lights earlier doesn't happen again.
Hey, look, Mr. Cousins, I'm going to check each circuit wire by wire. I'm going to try to find out what the trouble is. Now, is that all right with you? In the meantime, we are going to keep all of our lights on for 24 hours a day.
Although no precise computation has ever been made concerning the world's bat population, experts agree that the number would be in excess of 10 billion, perhaps as high as 50 billion. These mammals, primitive as they basically are, have an extraordinary history of adaptability to their environment. Whereas Homo sapiens has existed in his present form for a mere 2 million years, the order Chiroptera, the bat, has survived on Earth for over 60 million years.
Chris. Christina. Christina.
The space under Christina's bedroom door is the only possible way that they could have gotten in.
But how did they get into the complex at all?
Oh, we're going around in circles. That little lady's about as close to cracking as anyone ever has been. And if this happens to her again, you can just bet she'll be gone.
We all feel the same way, Mr. Cousin, so why don't you just take it easy?
There's a time to take it easy and there's a time for action. Now, I'm going to lay this whole thing out for you. Just what I think, just what I have believed from the very beginning. That this whole thing is a setup, and that someone down here is responsible for it. Only the one thing he didn't count on were these bats. So I am suggesting that that someone stand up now and admit to us what the hell this whole thing is about.
You're saying that that someone is me, right, Mr. Cousins?
That's exactly what I'm saying, Major.
Well, I'm gonna lay it out for you, mister. It is not me. You better start believing it. Anybody who would subject human beings to this kind of torture has got to be sick. And I don't think anybody down here is sick. Maybe inside, yes, but not up here. And you better let this sink in, Mr. Cousins. Up above, you might have been a great big man, huh? You had a lot of money, you had a lot of power, except there is no more up above. It's gone. Everyone up there is gone. They're wiped out. And maybe I even lost more than you. Now you get off my back, and you stay off my back, because there's just you and me and nine other people trying to stay alive down here. We're trying to make the best of a situation that could end up having us climbing the walls. I'm gonna do the best I can to see that that doesn't happen. Now, damn it, you do the same thing.
I agree with you, Gordon. I think we all agree with you that we've got to believe in each other. Because each other is all that we've got. All there is between man's surviving or becoming extinct. But if we're going to survive, it seems to me we've got to do something. I don't know what, but something to protect ourselves against those damn bats.
An alarm system. Why couldn't Gordon here rig up some kind of an alarm system? So that if the lights go out, at least no one will be caught sleeping through this kind of thing again.
Some sort of audio warning system. Yeah, that's possible. It'll take hours, though, for me to complete.
Then you don't think you're going to be able to find the problem about the lights?
I haven't yet. But until I do, a warning system's a damn good idea.
The group adjustments, which were beginning to take shape, are now seriously threatened by this most recent contact with bats. The experience has caused extreme depression and fear. It is possible the bats are trapped down here with us, sealed off. And though an alarm system cannot keep them away, it will warn us if they come again. And it must work, because it seems that this particular species of bat will attack humans without provocation.
What have we got there, Doctor?
Some medication for Christina. And what do you have there, Mr. Cousins?
Maybe you'd like to have one with me. Might take the edge off.
No, thank you.
You know, I think something is happening to me inside. I honestly do. I'm beginning to realize what an overwhelming opportunity this whole thing really is. I mean, the incredible idea that we could be the last of our kind and the first of a new species. I mean, that's fantastic.
All this from the bitter and cynical Mr. Mays? I don't believe it.
Yes, me, the congenital iconoclast. Full of hope and optimism.
You, the congenital artist. Thank goodness the computers were smart enough to give us one.
Hey.
A lousy little piece of gold to hang around your neck, and then they turn you out to pasture.
So how come he sent you down here? I'll tell you why he sent you down here. Because you're supposed to be a stud, that's what. You're nothing but a goddamn stud.
Hey, Mr. Cousins, why don't you go to bed?
Mays! You're crazier than anybody. You know that? I think you actually enjoy it down here. You are nuts up there, and you're nuts down here. And all that crap you wrote in your books there about man being replaced by machines. So what? I just wish we'd have lasted long enough up there to replace the likes of you.
Why don't you go to bed?
I don't want to go to bed. I was trying to change things. Change? Not satisfied with anything. Got to change everything, huh? I know none of you like me. I know.
Mr. Cousins, come on.
Now, leave me alone. You just all of you. All of you, leave me alone. Maybe before this is all over, you'll have to come to me. And you, doctor, studying my behavior. Just what is it you see?
Don't you think you better get some sleep?
Why don't you stop your stupid observing, all your spying? What are you keeping all the records for, huh? Posterity? That's a laugh.
Well, unless you know something I don't.
Why don't you get some sleep, doctor?
You better leave right now.
I only want to talk to you. Please.
What do you want to talk about?
Well, I mean, you don't feel it? Some conspiracy here? Some damn scheme? To wipe us out? Torture all of us? Something? We gotta do something. We gotta do something before it's too late. You understand that, don't you?
Everything has been done that can possibly be done.
We're all just gonna die down here. We're just gonna die if we don't just find some way to do something to get out of here. We gotta try to find some way to get out of here.
I know you're scared. And I know you're lonely. We're all lonely.
I need someone. You know what I mean? I just want to hold you. Let me hold you. I need you, don't you? Don't you?
You tell the rest of them we're going to test it in 5 minutes at 3:30 and not to worry about the lights, huh?
Dr. Chrisman? Dr. Chrisman?
Yes?
Gordon is ready to test the alarm.
Thank you.
Your Dead Time story this evening was filmed by Metro Media Productions in and around Mexico City and released by Columbia Pictures on May of 1974. Bats were caught in nets daily and used only for a single day. But unfortunately, many of them died throughout the production. As a result of this, both Jackie Cooper, who plays Raymond Cousins, and Barbara Babcock, who plays Dr. Christian Lorraine, went to the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences to try to find a way of universalizing animal treatment in American films that were shot in other countries. Jackie Cooper is best known for his portrayal as newspaper editor Perry White of the Daily Planet in the 4 Superman films, starring Christopher Reeve as the Man of Steel. Alex Cord, who plays Stephen Mays, is best known for his portrayal of Alexander Coldsmith Briggs III, a.k.a. Archangel, on the 1980s television program from CBS, Airwolf, starring Jan Michael Vincent and Ernest Borgnine. Diana Moldauer, who plays Alana Fitzgerald, can also be seen in 2 episodes of Star Trek, the original series, one playing Dr. Miranda Jones, and one playing Anne Mulholland, as well as Dr. Kate Pulaski on The Next Generation, who replaced Chief Medical Officer Dr. Beverly Crusher, played by Gates McFadden, during the 2nd season of the show. It's time for tonight's Monster Question. Bradford Dillman, who plays Peter McComber, can also be seen starring in a film where he has a bit of a slight infestation problem. Can you name that film and his role in it? Your answer awaits at the end of tonight's Fear Fable.
Where's Cousins?
He's in his room.
Still pretty shaky. He needs to sleep it off.
To stuff some towels underneath your bedroom doors, just in case, until I have a chance to install something a little more permanent. You understand?
Luis, it's important that you block the space at the bottom of your door. Raymond!
What happened?
Leave me alone.
What have you done?
I said leave me alone. Luis, come back. You gotta listen to me. Come back.
Have to be shorting the circuit. They just have to be.
I'll have all of you out of here in 45 minutes.
What?
There has been no thermonuclear attack.
What are you talking about?
This has been an experiment.
Then I was right. You son of a bitch. You son of a bitch.
Some life will survive. Now, a great deal of time and effort and money has gone into the planning and the construction of this installation. But it had to be tested. Would it work? Could a small group of highly productive survivors tolerate these conditions? And could they accept the fact that their world was gone, everything that they had, everyone that they knew? And this is what is most important. Could they get along with each other? Help each other? Could they cooperate? And to what degree? The law of all life is cooperation within the species.
Just how long was this experiment scheduled to last?
1 month, 30 days.
What about the pictures? The destruction that we saw?
Films made in the lab.
The explosions in the elevator.
All programmed. Everything was programmed.
The light failures.
That too. At least some.
Well, what about the bats? Were the bats part of your plan?
At first, I thought they were. I thought perhaps they were trying to test me, too.
And all this without hidden microphones, hidden cameras?
We couldn't chance any of you seeing them. It was all my personal responsibility to observe firsthand. Believe me, it is not the intention of scientists or the government to be cruel.
Cruel? Cruel? What the hell would you call it? You're a goddamn machine. You've been playing games with the lives of 10 people. What gives you, the government, or anyone else the right to jeopardize another man's life? More of that end justifies the means garbage, right?
Each of you should feel honored and privileged to have been chosen to participate.
Well, let me tell you something, Mr. McComber. Nothing justifies fooling around with another man's life. Nothing! Life is all we've got!
All right, I've had enough goddamn philosophy. Now let's get practical. Just what's gonna happen if that signal you sent doesn't work?
It will.
The damaged tube in the circuit room could affect it. There are thousands of sensitive relays wired through it. It's gonna take weeks to work it out. I don't know how much I can do.
The signal will work.
Well, it damn well better. And let me tell you something else, mister. When we get out of here, I'm going to file a lawsuit against you, the government, the Pentagon, and anybody else who had anything to do with this operation.
Yeah, well, if I've got this operation figured right, you won't have a chance.
What's going to stop me?
Denial, Mr. Cousins.
Denial of what? This entire operation?
No, it wouldn't be difficult. You just take the top off the bunker. There's no point of identification, right? It's just desert and mountains.
Oh, no, you don't! Now, nobody can deny the body of Luis Cabral!
If my guess is right, the government will dispose of anyone or anything who attempts to interfere with the security or completion of this project. Am I right, Mr. McComber?
You realize what she's saying? If it's true, you're talking about murder!
I'm talking about the survival of the human race, Mr. Cousins!
You are a machine! A brainwashed fool! And what's more frightening is that there must be hundreds more like you. I can't believe you're talking for any responsible authority.
Think about it, Raymond. And maybe you'll realize how blind you've been. The day of the individual in our world is gone. Passé.
A bell will ring at 4:43. And a red light will flash in the elevator shaft. It's the signal that the rescue helicopter is on the ground and that the elevator's mechanical controls have been made operational. Surface.
It's 4:43, McComber. It's 4:43.
The signal didn't get through.
It had to get through.
But if it didn't, when will they come?
The failsafe for this operation is very simple. If at the end of the first 10 days, they haven't received a coded signal from me, they come and check.
One man dead and five more days to go. You murderer!
I told you to be here!
He's right. Mr. Cousins is right. 5 more days. I don't think I could take 5 more minutes of this. Can somebody get me out of here, please? Somebody get me out of here.
No, nobody's going to get you out of here. None of us are going to get out of here. I told you all in the beginning you wouldn't listen to me. None of us are going to get out of here. We had our chance, but now it's gone. Tell him, McComber, it's gone, isn't it? Admit it!
I guess it didn't get through.
We are aware that living together in confined quarters, no matter how well designed, can cause personal problems that you may feel inclined to keep to yourselves. We suggest you don't. Talk them out with the behavioral scientist in your group. Think of the group, above all things, as a family. Get to know one another, and you will care about one another. Each other can become the most important thing in your lives.
I'm beginning to agree with you. About our world, where it's heading. I guess I was just too busy being busy to stop and think about it.
You see, when you're a kid, you think you're something special. Some of us grow up thinking it. You think you've got something to say. You say it. People buy it. Then you wait for something to be done about it. But it never is. It's too big up there. The whole thing, it's too big and getting bigger. People don't have time. People don't even have time for people. That's why I became so hyped on this place. It's not too big. It was a chance to start over again.
Stephen, I don't want to die. She got hold of some barbiturates.
Oh, Jesus.
How is she?
She'll live.
I think I found a way out.
How? Might be possible to climb the elevator shaft and set off the emergency alarm at the top.
1,700 feet straight up?
The elevator shaft has guide rails from top to bottom. Now, I could rig a safety harness and a headlamp.
Nobody could climb that distance.
I could. Out of the question. I won't allow it.
You don't have anything to do with it one way or the other.
It's
too dangerous. It won't work.
If Russo wants to try it, it's Russo's risk.
There's another way.
What other way?
Fight back.
Fight what? Fight who?
Shadow spots on the walls. If you can't see them and you can't hear them, how the hell are you going to fight them?
Bait them. Lay a trap. Make them come to us.
And then what?
Electrocute them.
Tell me something, you two. Did it ever occur to you that maybe even this is part of Mr. McComber's little game? Major Ellis suggested the elevator shaft. Mr. McComber shouted it down. Why? Was he afraid maybe it'd work? Was he afraid maybe we'd make it out of here before we're supposed to? All right, look. We've had our little disagreements. I got drunk, said some things I shouldn't have. No, I'm sorry. Believe me, I want to make it up to you. Are you listening?
Hey, man, we're not deaf. We hear you.
All right, now. I'm going to write a letter. A signed note. On a piece of paper that you can fold up and put in your pocket and carry up that elevator shaft with you. And on that note will be my guarantee to pay you $100,000 in cash. Within 1 week after you get me out of this hole. Now, that offer's gonna stand for 24 hours.
Dr. Crispin's ready for you now.
Take all you want, Doc.
We're taking a pint from everyone.
More blood, more bats.
Disconnected.
Yes.
Anything?
Nothing. Just wait.
back. Come on, get back.
Well, maybe if we were to wire the whole installation along ceilings, an entire network.
How long do you think that'll take?
We've listened to you long enough. What do you say? You're the only one who can save us.
When he asked me what my piece of coal was worth. 10 years of training, he said. And for what? A few moments of glory. Thing is, he was right. He was right about this jive caper being as phony as they come. And he was right about me. Yeah, I won the gold medal. But that was some time ago. Who even cares now? Who even remembers? Except for a few sports writers.
So you're gonna try again?
Carrie, I'd like those few moments of glory. I'd like to get them back. And you better believe if I can climb a 1,700-foot cave wall and get us out of here, I'll get it back and more. $100,000 more.
And if you can't?
Can't. I don't even know how to spell it.
I'm a man of my word. How does it look up there?
Hi.
What happens up on top?
That door was built to open from the inside in case of a jam. As soon as it does open, a signal will be relayed immediately to an Air Force base near the east.
Don't do it, Woody. We'll be out of here in a few days. You're risking your life for nothing. Don't you see that?
You had your chance. You blew it. Thank you.
hope he makes it. You believe that, don't you?
I believe it.
Thank you.
Good morning, chosen survivors, to the beginning of your second week in Complex 11. Let's take a few moments this morning to look back over your first week. Note the tremendous adjustments you have already made, the progress. You are proof of man's indomitable will to survive. And before long, your boundless energies will return through man's inherent desire to reach out. We feel confident you are now sufficiently oriented to have done some constructive thinking about the plans that must be made during the months and years to come. Discuss these plans amongst yourselves. Consider them thoughtfully. Man's ultimate destiny is in your hands. The bodies and minds of each of you have been exposed to tremendous stress. Cooperate with one another. Make allowances for each other's shortcomings. Henceforth, periodic group sessions are strongly recommended. Careful reasoning will result in judicious decisions. Take your time. Time is your key. Time and patience. You should feel proud and find comfort in the knowledge that yours is a responsibility with which no man has been entrusted before. The challenge is monumental, but one day soon, the sun will shine again, and all the world will be yours. This is Mary Louise Boyd. This message was pre-recorded and automatically programmed.
Why did it have to be bats? Not that kind. Now you've ruined the atmosphere. Go take that out and hit something with it. Don't even think about it. Kids. Now, let's reveal your answer to tonight's monster question. In what film does Bradford Dillman star in? Or he has a slight infestation problem. It was 1975, Bug, from Paramount Pictures. He played Professor James Parmeter, who discovers a previously unknown species of insect, which can cause fires by simply rubbing their legs together. Fang tells me, your tomb is prepared. But before you go slinking off to your own frightmares, let's see what terrors are lurking for you here. On your next stay at the Haunted Hotel. Thank you.
room.
Ejected from unexplored secret stratus, this giant, harder than steel piston, disgorges strange creatures, inundating our world, twisting the emotions of women, distorting our men.
This is a piece we got off the mayor. Reflex action like a snake. Cut a snake in half and the two pieces go off in different directions.
These things take over a man's mind? He becomes a robot? A machine taking orders?
Join the hunt for the hiding place of terror. Find the breeding place of these globs of destruction.
In feeding, the mouth parts rupture the cells, convey the food to the stomach by a pumping action.
It's an adventure that'll burst your blood vessels with suspense. See the Brain Eaters.
Brain Eaters. Your next Dead Time story. Be sure to make your reservation. And please like The Haunted Hotel on Facebook. Until then, I bid you all good night. Creep it real. And as always, rest in peace.